The following are airway management steps for patients with suspected COVID infection. Phase 1, preparation outside the room. When managing the airway and planning to intubate a suspected or confirmed COVID patient in the ICU setting, the following steps are recommended. Intubation is considered an aerosol-generating procedure. Therefore, ideally, this will occur in a negative pressure isolation room or alternatively, a single room with the door closed throughout. The code card is placed outside of the room. PPE materials should be readily available for 3 to 5 providers on code cards. The intubation team should be optimized and ideally limited to 3 to 5 providers inside the room. Backup should be available outside the room. If a difficult airway is anticipated, then calling for anesthesia or otolaryngology help early is recommended because of delays with PPE donning. A clear plan of action should be articulated between the team as part of preparation outside the room. The intubating team should don PPE outside the patient's room. The team at the cart is responsible for prepping medications and airway supplies while the intubating team are donning. All medications for rapid sequence intubation, including full dose muscle relaxant and any supportive medications such as code meds if deemed necessary, should be labeled and brought to the bedside. Various sizes of cuffed endotracheal tubes, oral airways, and supraglottic airways should be available. Phase 2, in-room preparation after donning. Intubating team roles include the laryngoscopist, who should be the most skilled proceduralist, likely the ICU attending, an airway assistant, likely the respiratory therapist, a nurse for medication administration, an event manager, such as a nurse practitioner or senior fellow, may be inside the room depending on attending preference. The respiratory therapist will check and assemble airway equipment, ensuring that the anesthesia bag setup, such as a Jackson Reese circuit, has a HEPA-approved viral filter at the patient end, that the ventilator is set up and ready with a viral filter on the expiratory limb of the circuit, and end-tidal CO2 monitoring is calibrated and warmed, ready for use on the ICU ventilator. Inline suction is in place, and the endotracheal tube tape is also prepared. If a non-mainline end-tidal CO2 system is used for monitoring, then additional precautions to prevent ventilator contamination will be necessary. The nurse will prepare a med line for drug administration, confirm working IV access. The laryngoscopist will optimize position and pre-oxygenate the patient using the lowest flow that is considered safe and necessary to maintain oxygenation. A good mask seal should be maintained. This is optimized with a two-hand technique. Positive pressure ventilation via bag mask ventilation is avoided if possible to minimize aerosolization, and if it's needed, the minimum rate and volume of positive pressure breaths should be given. If the event manager is in the room, they should be positioned as far from the airway as possible. If inside the room, they will turn the video scope on, ensure it is plugged in and in appropriate position. Use of video laryngoscopy is recommended to maximize success and also allow a greater distance between the proceduralist's face and the patient's airway. Phase 3, intubation. Communication during this phase is essential. When you're ready to begin induction, the nurse will administer rapid sequence intubation medications, including full doses of paralytics. Rapid sequence induction with or without modification is preferred. The laryngoscopist will avoid manual hand ventilation if possible as saturations allow, as masking may increase aerosolization. This may potentially mean brief desaturation. Apneic oxygenation may be considered with the understanding that it could potentially negatively impact mask seal. If needed, use the minimal rate and volume of positive pressure breaths required. intubation is performed as the patient becomes apneic. The fresh gas flow is turned off just as the laryngoscopist removes the mask from the patient's face to minimize aerosolization. Laryngoscopy and intubation should be performed with indirect viewing and on-screen confirmation of the endotracheal tube placement through the vocal cords. The respiratory therapist will immediately inflate the endotracheal tube cuff and then remove the stylet. The respiratory therapist will connect the ventilator circuit directly to the patient and initiate ventilation. The ventilator is immediately connected to minimize further disconnections. Positive pressure ventilation using the ventilator is only instituted after the cuff has been inflated. The respiratory therapist will confirm endotracheal tube intubation by presence of end-tidal carbon dioxide on the ventilator capnograph waveform and with misting in the endotracheal tube. Confirmation by auscultation should be avoided as possible to avoid further exposure. The laryngoscope blade remains in the patient's upper airway, confirming the endotracheal tube remains in situ. The respiratory therapist assumes control of the endotracheal tube so the laryngoscopist can remove the blade from the mouth, disconnect the blade, and place it into the designated container for cleaning and disinfecting. The respiratory therapist and nurse then secure the endotracheal tube. If intubation is not achieved, call for help early and avoid multiple intubation attempts. Insert a supraglottic airway to improve oxygenation and avoid mask ventilation.